My name is Natalie Vriend and I'm a research fellow at the University of Cambridge. I'm part of a collaborative team consisting of Chris Keelock at the University of Sheffield and Paul Brennan at the University College London. And this year we're presenting an exhibition with the title Setting a Speed Trap for an Avalanche at the Royal Society Summer Science Exhibition in London.
The research that we're talking about is the construction and development of a radar system for imaging large-scale snow avalanches. These are really important flows to understand because large-scale avalanches can destroy villages and really affect the livelihoods of people in mountain communities. The large-scale avalanches that we're interested in usually develop at the top of the mountain as a big slab failure of snow. So this large slab of snow detaches from the mountainside and starts sliding downhill. As it slides downhill, it starts to break up into blocks. Some of those larger blocks form a dense layer at the bottom that kind of clings to the mountainside, but smaller particles, smaller snowflakes, get entrained into a large powder cloud that surrounds that avalanche. And when you see it, you might not actually realise there's a dense layer underneath that. And in fact, one aim of our project is to zoom the radar through the powder cloud and actually see what's going on with this dense layer underneath. Because although the dense layer is somewhat slower and perhaps doesn't travel quite as fast as the powder cloud, it actually contains the most of the mass of the flow and therefore often is the more destructive part.
We do want to do controlled experiments to really measure certain parameters. And for that, we want to move from the large-scale field experiments to the small-scale laboratory experiments. We're using sand for this instead of snow, because it's really hard to do experiments with snow because it's melting in the laboratory. You may wonder, well, sand and snow are two different materials, but they actually behave in a very similar way because the grains in the snow and sand are both colliding, rolling, and interacting with each other. As the snow moves down the mountain, it carves channels, forming these static levees on the side and this flowing region of snow in the middle. This is the exact same principle that we find in the laboratory as well.
What you can see in this experiment is that the sand flowing down the slope has formed mounds either side of the flow that are helping to channel the other sand. This is helping to reduce the friction of the flow because the mounds are constraining how far out that sand is spreading. The result of this is that the sand is travelling further than one might otherwise expect. And we think that this is the reason that flows like avalanches or like pyroclastic flows perhaps travel further than we might initially expect.
Researchers have worked on the classic granular collapse experiment for over a decade, here at the University of Cambridge and elsewhere in the world. We put in an extra twist.
What we have here is a classic experiment that was actually pioneered in this department. A granular column, a column of granular particles of two different sizes, is suddenly released. And the experiment is a very simple experiment merely to find out how far those particles travel when the column collapses. What's interesting here is that with the two different sizes of particles, we find that the maximum extent that the particles travel is actually further than if the particles were all the same size. And how far they travel depends on how you pack them. If you put the smaller particles at the top, the largest extent of travel of any grain is larger than if you put the small particles at the bottom. So although this is a very simple experiment, it contains some quite complicated dynamics.
In nature, we find the segregation phenomenon as well. In snow avalanches, the big particles are moving to the front of the avalanche, while the small particles are centered in the middle.
And understanding that interaction is important for understanding how the flow of an avalanche coupled to its powder cloud really behaves. So a large-scale avalanche, the ones that we're interested in, may well be travelling well over 100 miles an hour. So what we need to do is acquire our data quite fast.
Our radar measures the velocity of an avalanche every 75 centimetres, 50 times per second, over a distance of more than 2 kilometres.
It works on the basic similar principle to the way a police speed camera works, except rather than visualising one single object moving along a motorway, for example, a car, we're actually seeing what the avalanche does over a 3 kilometre distance every 75 centimetres. This means we can track the front of the dense part of the avalanche, and we can also try to work out the internal flow structure further back in the avalanche.
It's important that we understand the dynamics of snow avalanches. We want to know how fast an avalanche moves, what kind of pressures are exerted on structures and how far the avalanche runs out.
Using this information, we can try to improve numerical models for the flow, therefore improve the risk assessments for mountain communities, construction of towns, construction of hospitals, all those sorts of buildings in mountain areas.